Good, ladies and gentlemen, since it's time to start this last day of the school, all this day will be dedicated to neurodegeneration. And the first speaker, let me introduce Professor Paola Sacerdote from the University of Milan. She is professor of pharmacology. Of course, now I don't know which department I should say, so I will just say in the University of Milan, and she is graduating in biological sciences, and she has a PhD in neuropharmacology at the NIH. During all her career, Paola Sacerdote has studied a lot of things in the field of neuroimmunology, and maybe we can just start to say neuroimmunopharmacology, and in particular, the relationship between the central nervous system and the immune system in PEI. She contributed to identify the role of opioid peptides and beta endorphin in the modulation of the immune responses, and in particular in the regulation of the balance between TH1 and TH2 cytokines. And she did a lot of work analyzing the immunopharmacological profile of different analgesic drugs to identify molecules devoid of immunosuppressive properties which could be used safely in the treatment of pain. She also contributed to the demonstration of the role of pro-inflammatory cytokines produced in the nervous system, in particular in neuropathic pain models. And it seems to me that she will talk to us today just about this topic. So please, I'm very pleased to invite Paola Sacerdote to give us her talk.
Grazie, è un piacere. It's a pleasure for me to be there. He asked me to talk English so everybody can understand. It's a pleasure to be here. He's really a very good friend, and since many years we have somehow collaborating, if not in the research, at least in this kind of events. So it's really a pleasure to be here. What I'm going to talk today is the neuroimmune interaction in pain. But first of all, before going to neuroimmune, I would like just to spend a few words on what is pain, since I'm not sure that everybody of you knows the basis, the molecular basis of pain. So in the first 5-10 minutes, I will just talk a little bit about pain. I need to summarize the data, since I can speak 1.5 hours only on the basic mechanism of pain, of course, but just to give you a few information. So Clifford Wolf, who is really one of the major scientists involved in pain, asked in this beautiful recent review, what is this thing called pain? And and what is important to know is that we have different kind of pain. So we have nociceptive pain. Nociceptive pain is the easiest, the most simple way of type of pain. For example, if I touch a fire, a flame, or a very hot pot, immediately I move away my hand because I don't want to destroy my tissue. So this is the basic reason why we feel pain. So when we have a noxious stimuli that can be heat, cold, or intense mechanical force or chemical irritants, we activate a neuronal pathway, and this neuronal pathway lead to the feeling of pain. And this pain is adaptive. It's very important, and it is a protective signal in order to prevent damage to our organism. A second type of pain, very important and very studied, is inflammatory pain. This derives, of course, from a peripheral inflammation or tissue damage, where we have a lot of cells releasing substances which can activate the nociceptive pathways and leading to the sensation of pain. Also, this type of pain has to be considered adaptive. Why do we feel pain when we have an inflammation? Because so we can, for example, not move too much or not stress our joint, so leading to repair of the joint, for example, of an inflamed joint. However, what is important to say is that what the pharmacologists really deal every day with is the problem of pathological pain. When pain becomes chronic and long-lasting for a long period of time, pain is not anymore a danger signal, but it becomes a disease. So pathological and chronic pain is a disease that needs to be treated. Why do we go to pathological pain and to chronic pain? I will show you in the next slide, but one of the most frequent cases of pathological pain is a neuropathic pain where we have a damage directly to the neural structures, for example, the nerve, or the central nervous system itself. And the peripheral nerve damage of the destruction of the tissue itself leads to a pain sensation which is long-lasting and that keeps going on also in the absence of the reason, of the cause that really started pain. Even more challenging is now the conception, the concept of dysfunctional pain, which is, for example, a disease like fibromyalgia, where the patients have pain and it is not possible to find any reason for that, not even a damage to a nervous tissue. But this has to be considered anyhow a disease that needs to be treated. So different kind of pain, and I will talk a little bit of inflammatory pain and of neuropathic pain mostly. But why, when we have in the periphery the release, for example, the tissue that is damaged in inflammation, or just, for example, if we put our hand on a fire, why do we feel something? Because we have, of course, the nociceptors. The nociceptors are present in the periphery, in the skin, but also in the organs, also in the visceral organs. And these nociceptors, which are sensory fibers, free endings of sensory fibers, are extremely rich of any kind of receptors. The fiber, the sensory, the nerve, the free nerve endings of sensory fibers are really constructed in order to receive the information from a lot of substances because they are full of receptors. So this happens here. At this point, the messages start to be activated. There is pain, there is inflammation, and the message is translated into neural activity. It goes through the nociceptive pathways, of course, and it arrives first in the first synapse here in the spinal cord, in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. And in this position, we have the release by the first sensory fibers of some important transmitters, first of all glutamate and substance P. And at this point, we activate the secondary ordering neurons, which start to go up to the brain and is transporting the message of pain. Let's have a look, more closer look, to the sensory fiber. Here in the periphery, you see here there are a lot of channel and of channel receptors, so of ionotropic receptors. For example, one of the most important of these receptors, which has recently been discovered and a lot of studies have been done, is the TRIP V1 channel, and this channel is activated by capsaicin, which is the active ingredient of the red pepper, for example, by endovanilloids, but for example also by noxious heat. So heat over 42 degrees directly activates this receptor. And for this reason, we have the cations, which start to enter into the cells. This leads to depolarization, excitation of the fibers, and so the peripheral heat is translated into a neural, a firing of the neuron. Many other receptors, so for example, the ASIC receptor, which responds to protons, so to low pH condition. ATP receptors are very important. Other sodium channel, voltage-gated channels, and so on. And then, on these fibers, we have other metabotropic receptors, first of all, the bradykinin receptor and the prostaglandin receptors. The bradykinin receptors are not, of course, activating directly a calcium channel, but they can lower the threshold, for example, of the TRPV1 receptor. So these receptors start to be activated at a lower threshold and will lower stimuli. So a very rich fiber full of these receptors. In the periphery, when we have the production of all these different substances that are called zuppa infiammatoria o minestra infiammatoria, inflammatory soup in English, we have bradykinin, serotonin, histamine, prostaglandin, leukotrien, so many, many of these that activate our sensory fibers, which are A-delta fiber, which are fiber which are slightly myelinized, and C-fiber, which is not myelinized, which is amyelinic fibers. Some of the slides are in Italian, but of course it's not a problem. That was quite simply. If you really want to go into the detail of the receptors present in the sensory the sensory fibers, you can go to look at this recent review as well, where heat, cold, mechanical stimulation, different channels are involved, different subtypes, TRPV, for example, for heat. They have the TRPA, which is probably the channel which responds to cold. So different and a lot, a wide range of these channels present on the sensory fibers. This is the way how from the periphery we can start feeling pain. So periphery, activation here. We have the transportation along the neuron, and first synapse in the spinal cord, substance P and glutamate. Very important is the fact that besides the ascending nociceptive pathway leading from the periphery up to the brain, we also have descending controlling pathways, which are extremely important, also because, for example, when we use a drug for pain, very often we stimulate these descending pathways. Descending pathways, which are activated by opioids here, and these descending pathways release noradrenaline and perhaps serotonin, and these pathways can decrease and inhibit and lower the threshold, so they are descending inhibitory pathways. Of course, after the spinal cord, so after the synapse here, the pathway leading the nociceptive pathways go up to the brain. And I'm not going into detail, so I'm not going to talk in my presentation today of the upper center involved in pain. I will stop here at the spinal cord level. But it's very important to say that pain, as we consider it, is a complex feeling that comes from what I've told to you now, so the activation of the peripheral nociceptors and so on, but need to be integrated at the cortex level in order that we can really say, okay, we feel pain. So there is an emotional component in the final feeling of pain that is anyhow activated by this by all these mechanisms in the periphery. So making a summary, when we have an adequate stimulus in the periphery, we have the transduction, which means cold, heat, chemical, tissue injury. We have transduction into an electrical signal. We have transmission throughout to the spinal cord and up to the upper centers, where we have modulation and finally perception. On all these, again, the descending inhibitory control by noradrenaline, serotonin, and endorphin. What is really important for people studying pain is the concept of sensitization. Sensitization means that after an acute stimulus, you can have an increase of the response to the stimulus itself. So you have a lower the thresholds leading to neuronal activation become lower. How does this happen? We can have a peripheral sensitization. For example, very simple stimuli. In this case, we have a strong mechanical stimuli. You just put your feet on a nail. Ah, okay. And so you have the activation of the first C fiber, and what I told you before start to happen. But even when the stimulus is taken away, sometimes it can happen that, or if the processing, this processing goes for a longer period of time, you can have the production of several inflammatory mediators in the periphery, of the inflammatory soup in the periphery. So these substances, which are produced by this very punctate stimulus, for example, start to diffuse in the skin. And so new fibers can be activated. So one stimulus here activate first one single fiber, just to give an example. And after a while, some other fibers can be recruited. Moreover, after a while, what happened? Happened that the fiber itself, when it is activated for a long period of time, start to release substances like substance P, which further activate the tissue, induce vasodilation, edema, and so on. This is called neurogenic inflammation because substance P is produced and released in the periphery by the fiber, by the nerve fiber itself. And all these, so, lead to what is called sensitization. So one single stimulus can lead to a widening of the field of reception of the skin, for example, and the stimulus and the response can last for a long period of time. Even more important and very difficult to control is central sensitization. Central sensitization takes place in the spinal cord. What is central sensitization? Almost the same concept. In normal condition, we have a stimulus, we have the activation of the first synapse, release of glutamate and substance P. If the stimulus keep on going, the release of substance P and of glutamate persist over time. And this leads to activation of other receptors. First of all, for the NMDA receptor, you should know that when you release glutamate, you activate the AMPA receptor first, and when the depolarization is sustained for a while, for a long period of time, the depolarization is sustained, the NMDA receptors becomes activated, and the calcium start to enter into the cell. This is a phenomenon which is really present in pain, and it makes the difference. Acute pain becoming chronic pain. So you have the activation of this NMDA receptor, and you have, what is really important, a complete alteration of the structure of the synapse. You have a plastic neuronal plasticity which takes place at this point, and so all the synapse start to change. You have, for example, the production of new sprouting of new fibers, of new nerve, of new dendritic spines. So a lot of really of different changes, also of structural changes in the spinal cord, which lead to the perpetration of pain and the maintenance of pain. And this type of pain, when we have this alteration and this neuroplasticity in the spinal cord, is very difficult to treat from a pharmacological point of view. Some type of pain are in fact very difficult to treat and are not normally treated with classical drugs like opioids, for example. Because at this point you have really a general change in the synapse. I would like just to point out the terminology that I will use during my presentation. So I will talk a lot about hyperalgesia and allodynia. These are measures that we also perform in the animal when we study pain in the animal. And when you have chronic persistent pain, you can have hyperalgesia. Hyperalgesia is an increased response to a painful stimulus, and it is caused by sensitization of peripheral nociceptors or by sensitization of central neurons that carry nociceptive information. So a stimulus which normally is painful becomes more painful. Just to give you an example, when you take a shower, at 38, with the water at 38 degrees, normally you just feel a little bit, or 39 degrees, you feel a little bit of heat, but not too much. But if you take a shower after staying one day in Sardinia on the beach and you get sunburned, the same water, 38 degrees, become extremely painful, hyperalgesia. Allodynia is caused by a change in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, and in this case, also information which normally are not painful become painful. If you put on your shirt, the tissue, the fabric of your shirt, just on your skin, becomes painful. So this is becoming, of course, extremely difficult to live with for a patient, because he cannot put his foot on the ground, because he's feeling pain just with the foot on the ground, or he cannot really wear, or he cannot stay on one side in the bed because he's feeling pain just where he's normally is just laying and is normally having the sensation of the tact, the feeling, the sheath. So this is allodynia. So these are the two main symptoms which take place in chronic pain and in pathological pain. Just to give to explain a little bit more in detail what that allodynia means. In a normal, when you have a normal sensitization, you have pain, but the pressure, the low threshold mechanoreceptors, which normally are activated, for example, in this case by a feeder, you feel only touch. But when you have central sensitization, the low threshold mechanoreceptor somehow make a contact with the neurons that normally process pain, you see here, and so the touch of the feeder is not felt only as touch, but become felt as pain. And this is allodynia. Neuropathic pain is one of the most used example of central sensitization. It's a challenge for the pain pharmacologist, and is a pain arising as a direct consequence of a lesion or a disease affecting the somatosensory system. It can be caused by a disease or a lesion to both the central and the peripheral nervous system. And there are many conditions in the human which lead to neuropathic pain. For example, mechanical nerve injury of compression, low back pain has a very strong neuropathic component. Spinal cord injury, metabolic disease. In diabetes, there is an injury to the nerve fibers, and so you can have a neuropathic pain. And many other conditions. Viral disease, in HIV you have neuropathic pain. Some drugs which are used to treat pain, for example cisplatinum, need somehow to be, the dose need to be reduced, or the patients need to change the chemotherapy drug because a neuropathy appears, and many other conditions. For example, herpes zoster is another type of neuropathic pain. When you have herpes zoster, fuoco di Sant'Antonio, sometimes, luckily not all the time, but sometimes when the viral disease is disappeared, the person remains with neuropathy. So by touching the skin where the fuoco di Sant'Antonio was, the patients can feel allodynia. So many conditions that can lead to neuropathic pain. Just an important point that I would like to address, the question of pain research. In all the studies in science, of course, are difficult to perform in the human. But the studies for pain are even more difficult than other to be performed in the human, because it's very difficult to use a human volunteer to study pain, because, of course, the experiment on pain using human subjects are practically difficult. There is a strong subjective feeling of pain, an emotion of pain, so it's not easy to study pain for this reason in human. So they are, I would say, ethically self-limiting. For sure, in the next years, many important new studies will be done in the human. Many already have been published by using pain-related neuroimaging studies. For example, functional NMRI has really give a lot of information about which are the area which are activated by pain or by other stimuli. So particularly in pain research, we cannot really go without using animal models. And so most of the study I will present you today will be on animal model that we use normally are acceptable to study pain. And are necessary. A criticism, there are some criticism. In fact, if you look at the literature in the last 10 years, there is really been a very large number of studies, of basic pain studies. But the drugs, the new drugs that entered, that arrived in the pipeline, that arrived to the patients, new ones are really very, very few. We are still looking for some new drug in the patients for pain. So a lot of basic science is still difficult to translate into drug. But of course, we are really hoping that in the next year something will change. No. An example, the number of studies in animal studying pain has really increased a lot in the last years, you see here. These are the number of published papers on pain studies. Not many until the 1980. After the 1980, a large number of studies started to be presented in the literature, mainly for two reasons. One, because in the 1985, more or less, new important neuropathic pain models started to appear. So this neuropathic pain that I've told to you before, finally had some good animal models. And then another interesting thing that can be really somehow funny is the fact of the animal used for pain. You see here, for many years, the rat was the main animal used. From 1995, the mice started to be used and is now reaching the number of rat. Why? Because we started to use knockout and knock-in, so genetically modified animals. So now the main research of pain is made on mouse. In Italy, it's made on mouse also because somehow the mouse is still less expensive than rat, and this is something that is important, of course, at least the maintenance expenses, but also for this other reason. Okay, this was pain. And so why are we talking here in a neuroimmune school of pain? The first idea is about inflammatory pain. When I've talked to you about the different inflammatory soup that are able, so all the substances that are able to activate all the receptors of the nociceptors, I told about bradykinin, prostaglandin, ATP, ions, hydrogen ions, heat, cold. I did not talk about cytokine. So the first thing I would like to talk now, to give you the information, is about cytokines and the role that cytokines can have in mediating inflammatory pain. You can tell me, okay, we all know inflammation is made of immune cells. So of course cytokines are important in inflammatory pain. Yes. But the concept is that for many years, cytokines and immune cells were looked at only as the starter of all the event leading to pain. So cells like macrophage, neutrophils, mastocytes, mast cells were infiltrating, for example, the injured tissue. They were releasing cytokines. These cytokines were activating other macrophages, which were leading to the production of bradykinin, prostaglandin, and these were the substances sensitizing and activating the nociceptor. The concept started to change when cytokine receptors were found on the peripheral sensory neurons. So, among the many signals which are able to activate directly the nociceptive fibers, we have to put also cytokines. We have receptors for IL-1, for TNF on sensory fibers, and by binding to these receptors, our cytokines can modulate nociceptive transmission. How does this happen? It is not extremely clear yet, But it's very likely that by binding to their specific cytokine receptors, we have a downstream activation of second messengers inside the nociceptors, which can either directly modulate channels or activate, for example, the release of substance P. And it also, there are also some very interesting data showing how by activating cytokine receptors on the nociceptors, the TRPV1 thresholds are decreased. So the ability of pro-inflammatory cytokines to activate, to become one of the many substances directly activating the nociceptors, leading to pain. It's a subtle distinction, but it's very important. So cytokines not only orchestrating the immune responses, but cytokines also directly modulating the nociceptive transmission. However, if we look at the many different substances which are produced by cells of the immune system, among these, we have for sure pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-1 and TNF, which can activate the nociceptors. But the same immune cells are able also to produce anti-inflammatory cytokines, which makes exactly the opposite, which can try to decrease the feeling of pain. Or, even more important, immune cells can also produce, for example, opioid peptides that can try to lower the nociceptive thresholds. So we have to see at the immune system, at least in inflammatory pain, as an important system which by producing pro-inflammatory cytokines can make pain, and by producing the anti-inflammatory cytokines and opioid peptides can decrease pain. So the next 5 minutes, I would like to focus on this point, on how the immune system interacts with the nociceptor in pain in order to decrease pain sensation. How does this happen? With opioid receptors. Opioid receptors are receptors present, of course, in all the nociceptive transmission pathways. And when we activate these receptors, we can have different effect, like the inhibition of calcium influx, the increase of potassium efflux, and we have the decrease, the inhibition of CAMP formation by inhibiting adenylate cyclase. So all these lead in the central neurons and in the spinal cord neurons to hyperpolarization of neurons and to inhibit neurotransmission release. But where are supposed to be these receptors? Here, in the spinal cord, and here, in the periaqueductal gray, so in the brain. Recently, and this is a beautiful work from the group of Stein and Schaffer, and we also did some in this field, it was demonstrated that opioid receptors were present also on the nociceptors, on the free nerve ending, where we are all the story of today started. So together with all the receptor, the channel, the metabolotropic receptors leading to pain activation, we also have opioid receptors here. These opioid receptors are synthesized in the dorsal root ganglia, and they are, of course, transported along the axon down to the periphery. Extremely important, these receptors increase. Io posso finale un'ora e mezza, vero? Sì. These receptors, the number of these receptors increase in the periphery when you have inflammation. For example, if you give IL-1, which is a pro-inflammatory cytokine, the number of opioid receptors on nociceptor fibers are increased. Look here, and this is control. So in the presence of inflammation, you have an increase in the number of these opioid receptors in the periphery. This inflammation also increases the number of receptors in the periphery. And so we have a first new idea that we can use peripherally opioid agonists in order to block pain. And it's possible that at the beginning of an inflammatory pain or an inflammatory process, the effect of opioids are mainly central because only few receptors are present on the peripheral nerve fibers. But after a while, when you have an inflammation going on, you can have receptors also on peripheral sensory fibers, and so also the peripheral analgesic effect of opioids can become important. Okay. But the question is, which opioid is binding the receptors present on these nociceptors? And here the immune system come in the story again, because immune cells like macrophages and lymphocytes can produce and release opioids like beta endorphin. And these opioids released by cells of the immune system can bind to the receptors present on the peripheral nervous system and try to block or at least to diminish pain sensation. These are a series of now very old studies that we conducted in our laboratory, and we looked at the amount of beta endorphin present in the cells obtained from patients with different kind of pain. Different, absolutely different kind of pain with different mechanism at the basis of the pain, like cluster headache, migraine, endometriosis, fibromyalgia, arthritis, osteoarthritis. These are lymphocytes. When we looked at inside the cells, we found very low amount of beta endorphin. But a lot of this beta endorphin was really released from the cells. So the cells were activated to actively release beta endorphin in the presence of different pain conditions. And this beta endorphin was trying to contrast the ongoing pain in this subject. So it's very, if you look in the whole what I've told to you, it's really very interesting because the same cells, immune cells, which produce cytokines, which induce pain, are also able to produce beta endorphin that decrease pain. So the same cells can really be seen as good cells and as bad cells, of course, for pain. So the same cells which can release cytokines arrive here in the where the inflammation is, for example, and of course they can try to contrast pain. Intracellular pathways leading to the release of beta endorphin by different immune cells has been well studied. Also by Stein and by our group, and so we clearly demonstrate that it's a calcium-dependent release of beta-endorphin from the cells and so on. But what is really interesting, so in order to conclude this part, is that the same mechanism that make the opioid to be a very important analgesic in the central nervous system can also make them be important analgesic in the periphery. So by the release of these opioid peptides in the periphery, we can block substance P release, we can block the activation of the many channels than the receptor that I've told to you before. And so we have this immune system, we have to look at the immune system, both as generator of pain in the periphery as well as generator of analgesia. Let's now move to a different type of pain, which is a neuropathic pain, and on the study that we and many other, of course, have done in the last year in order to study the role of the immune system in this pain. In fact, what was really emerging from this study was the idea that beside the neurons, other cells are important in the appearance, in the onset, and in the maintenance of neuropathic pain. And these other cells are, of course, immune cells, or let me better specify, cell-producing cytokines. So I'm now trying to demonstrate you, to convince you, that several types of cells that are present in the nervous system itself can produce and release cytokines in the nervous system when you have a neuropathic lesion, and that this is important for the maintenance of neuropathic pain. So not only neurons, but other cells. Why is it important? Because we now can look at new target cells to treat pain. Since the many treatments that we have in our hands to treat pain targeting the neuron are not as effective as we would like. Which are these cells? When this is a nerve, we have a lesion of the nerve, and what happens? We have in the lesioned nerves several cells which can produce cytokines. Which are these cells? First of all, Schwann cells itself. So the Schwann cells themselves, they can start to produce cytokines when the tissue is lesioned. Then we have always in the nerve, we have the macrophage and the T lymphocytes. Macrophage, we have resident macrophages in the nerve, as well as infiltrating macrophages. And we have infiltrating mast cell and T lymphocytes. So the first point, the first source of cytokines is the nerve itself. Ganglio, dorsal root ganglion. Also in the dorsal root ganglion, you have cells like satellite cells. Satellite cells are the glia of the ganglion that when activated can start to produce cytokines. But also in this case, you have macrophages and T lymphocytes that can infiltrate and start to produce cytokines. And finally, and of course extremely important, in the spinal cord, where you have the first synapse between neurons, you have microglia, microglial cells, resident microglial cells that become activated and can start to produce cytokines. So focusing on the nerve, again, macrophage, neutrophils, mast cells, T cells producing different type of cytokines, and also Schwann cells here, which are immediately upon lesion of the nerve able to produce cytokines. In the dorsal root ganglia, satellite cells, a lot of receptors and that can lead to the production of cytokines. And in the spinal cord, you have microglia cells producing cytokines like IL-1, TNF, IL-6, which can then modulate the activity of the primary, of the second neurons and the first neurons. What we did in our lab, just to show you how you can study this kind of problem. We use a model which is the chronic constriction injury model. There are many models you can use in order to induce neuropathic pain in the animal. This is one of the most used one and widely accepted. You make a ligature with a silk thread around the sciatic nerve. And after a while, you have nerve compression, Wallerian degeneration, epineural inflammatory lesion, leading to the symptoms of neuropathic pain, hyperalgesia and allodynia. You can really, luckily for pain researcher, there is the sciatic nerve, because we really always use the sciatic nerve in order to induce neuropathic pain by either cutting it or constricting it and different kind of model, but the concept that we really induce a damage to the nerve, to a peripheral nerve. In this slide from a paper from our group, we show the amount, the production of IL-1 and IL-6 in the sciatic nerve, in the dorsal root ganglia, and in the spinal cord after the CCI ligature, so after the injury to the nerve. These are mRNA levels, but also protein levels are quite similar. And you see immediately after 3 days, 3 days after ligature, you can see an increase of IL-1, and this increase in the sciatic nerve remains up to 14 days. Also, IL-6 is activated. In dorsal root ganglia, the interleukin-1 levels are also increased, but starting a little bit later. So you have like a flux of information going from the nerve towards the spinal cord. And also in the spinal cord, IL-1 is important. While IL-6 seems to be important more peripherally, so in the nerve and in the dorsal root ganglia. This is the protein, which really parallels the mRNA. Because you know that when we perform this kind of study by looking at mRNA, you cannot, by measuring the mRNA expression, this does not necessarily mean that you really have an increased amount of protein, because you can have mRNA, but this cannot be translated into protein or can be rapidly degraded. So it's always very important to have both the mRNA and the protein, since this is a course. I would like to point out a few things. When I told before about cytokines, I also made the name of tumor necrosis factor. Tumor necrosis factor, TNF, is the first pro-inflammatory cytokine which is normally produced by an immune system. But in the previous slide, I did not show TNF. Why? Because we first looked at cytokines starting from 3 days after the lesion. And we couldn't really find a very good modulation of TNF. So we thought, maybe TNF is so precocious that we couldn't see it because it was increased earlier. In fact, in a new series of studies, we went to look at TNF much earlier in time, and what we saw that already 6 hours after the lesion, you have a significant increase of TNF levels in the nerve. These levels of TNF are still present 1 day after the damage, after the injury, but 3 days later, the increase is not present anymore. These are graphs showing behavioral. This is hyperalgesia, so normally you have thermal hyperalgesia. Normal animal can have higher thresholds. When you perform the CCI injury, you see the levels go down. And this is allodynia. So normal animal, the thresholds go down. And the thresholds go down very, very early, already 6 hours after the ligature, when TNF is increased. So our idea is that TNF is a very precocious marker of activation. It, at the beginning, involved in the neuropathic pain, but then disappeared, and probably later on, other cytokines, like for example IL-1, becomes more important. This is interesting, but unfortunately makes it difficult in treating neuropathic pain with TNF antagonist, for example, because the window you have to use in order to treat is very, very narrow, since you have to block TNF only at the beginning, because later on probably is too late. So after we have characterized the cinetic, the temporal activation of cytokines in the nerve, we wanted to analyze whether different pharmacological treatments could affect pain, decrease pain, of course, but also decrease cytokines or somehow affect cytokines. And so we performed, of course, many studies. I'm presenting you only a few of them, showing the effect of some treatments targeting different neurotransmitter or different substances in the model of neuropathic pain on behavior and on cytokines. The first data I would like to present to you are about the ATP. ATP is, besides being, of course, the most important signal for energy in the cells, the store for energy, is an important mediator. And when it is released from damaged cells, which can really release a lot of ATP, ATP can bind to different receptors and participate in pain by activating both the peripheral nerve and the spinal cord. So we wanted to target ATP in our model, and we used an antagonist when you need to block a substance. Very often in research you use antagonist, and we use this antagonist, which is called the PPATS. This is a non-selective antagonist for the purinergic receptors. I don't want to go into detail about the purinergic receptors, but there are many purinergic receptors. The P2X are ionotropic receptor, the P2Y are metabotropic receptors. PPDS is a non-selective. It's probably more P2X than P2Y, but anyhow, we didn't really want to go into the detail of the receptor. We just want to try to see what was happening when we were blocking one of the signal danger released from the damaged cells. The P2X receptors are present almost everywhere in the pathways leading to nociceptive transmissions. They are present, for example, on macrophages, so it was possible that with the PPATS we were really blocking the receptors on the macrophages in the nervous tissue. But receptors are present also in the ganglia, so we can also bind and so inactivate the receptor in the ganglia. But also in the microglia cells, there are a lot of P2X for ATP receptors. So what we did in the study, we performed the ligature, then we gave PPATS to the animals, to mice, for a certain period of time. Normal animals, normal, no pain. You have pain when you have the lower of thresholds, thermal and allodynia and mechanical thresholds. With PPATS, so by blocking the ATP receptors, we were able to see a significant amelioration of the painful symptom, since the animal, in a dose-related way, really did not show any painful behavior anymore. Then we looked at cytokines, IL-1 and IL-6. So we waited for a while until we had pain. When the cytokines were high in the nerve, we gave PPATS, and you can see here that we were able to decrease the production of IL-1 in the nerve. So by targeting ATP receptors, we were able to block the development of painful sensation and also to block the increase of cytokines, of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And this was done in parallel. This is a nerve, but there was similar results that were obtained also in the dorsal root ganglia and in the spinal cord. Non solo cytokines, not only cytokines, but other inflammatory parameters of the nerve were ameliorated by the treatment. For example, the production of NOS, the NAO is an inflammatory mediator, the NF-kB transduction, transcription factor, was also blocked by PPATS. So a series of neuroinflammatory parameters were blocked by PPATS, and in parallel we were able to see a decrease of the painful activation of the painful stimuli. So by blocking the receptor in all this pathway from the nerve to the central nervous system, we block the pain and we block the cytokines activation. Another example, of course we use different drugs, but I have to go to a conclusion. And different example, completely different approach that can be of interest for some of you, the use of stem cells. In a paper that we just published in Pain, we used neuronal stem cells in order to ameliorate neuropathic pain and pro-inflammatory cytokine production in the nerve. These are neuronal cells that the group of Angelo Vescovi at Bicocca gave us, adult neural stem cells. And we injected the cells intravenously in the mice, in the caudal vein of the mice, and we started with 1 million of cells. Our idea was that the cells were going to localize and in the inflamed, in the damaged nerve, because this is known from the literature that when you have a damaged tissue, you have the release of chemokine, of cytokines, and these activate stem cells in the injured locus. And we tried to see whether our stem cell treatment was able to modulate pain. So we wanted to analyze the homing of our cells in the nerve. We wanted to see the effect on the neuropathic pain symptoms. We wanted to look at the biochemical changes, and also if the cells were somehow able to trigger some nerve repair in the sciatic nerve of the animal. We waited until the pain was present and the cytokines were high. We injected 1 million cells first, then in a second experiment we doubled the number of cells. We tried to see to a dose response effect. And 14 and 21 days later, we measured cytokines, RNA, IL-1, IL-6, and also IL-10, which is an anti-inflammatory cytokine, and we studied nerve morphology. And of course, we evaluated behavior. Just a point that I actually had to tell you before. Why did we choose to start our treatment not immediately at the moment of the lesion, but later on? Because our idea was always, of course, to try a treatment which can be eventually used in the human. And very often the patients arrive to the pain clinician and he has already developed pain. It doesn't come before pain. There are some conditions where you can somehow expect that pain would be arising. For example, after amputation. After amputation, you can really expect that in some case neuropathic pain can develop. But many often for neuropathic pain in the patients, for example, in diabetic patients, appears later on. So we also in the animal, we wanted to work in animal where pain was already present, so that our treatment, even if experimental, of course, could be considered therapeutical. And also in this case, we waited 1 week after the injury when the nerve was lesioned, the cytokines were high, and the pain was present. First of all, the cells. The cells were transfected with GFP, so we were able to see the cells in the nerve by immunocytochemistry. The cells immediately, 24 hours after injection in the caudal vein, were present in the nerve tissue, were very much representative there 3 days, and also 7 days are still present. This is not a beautiful section, but after 7 days are still present. 14 days later, they start to disappear. So they start in the nerve for a short period of time, short, I don't know, 2 weeks, or at least we are able to measure them for 2 weeks. Interestingly, if you look at animal treated with the cells, but the same, this is the same animal, the contralateral nerve that is not injured, we couldn't see any cells. And if you give cells to sham animal where you do not have any kind of lesion, we couldn't find any cells in the nerve. Behavior. With the cells, one injection at 7 days was able to ameliorate painful symptoms up to 35 later. So one injection of the cells was able to ameliorate the symptoms, and the effect lasted for at least 3 weeks. Hyperalgesia and allodynia. When we gave a double injection, so 2 million of the cells, the effect was higher, you can see here. So it's like giving a double drug doses. So we were also able with the cells to see a drug response. And when we gave, I don't think that I have the slide, no, okay, but just for information, here when amelioration of pain start to decrease, if you give cells one more, so after 3 weeks, you are still able to ameliorate pain. So every time you give cells, you can ameliorate pain, and the relief from pain lasts for a few weeks. What about cytokines? Very interesting results, of course. If not, I wouldn't present them here. So IL-1 was increased in the nerve, and after stem cells, the stem cells were able to do something, probably to change the milieu or to talk with the other cells in the nerve, and the IL-1 production was decreased. And also the IL-6 production was decreased. Interestingly, when you look at IL-10 production in the nerve, this is the CCI animals, you see in the CCI animal an increase of IL-10 production. Why? What we and others, of course, proposed is the fact that IL-10 is a pro-inflammatory cytokine. It tends to decrease inflammation, and so the system is actively produced the IL-10 in order to counteract the activation of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And in this case, what we did, we observe after stem cells administration, we observed the stem cells were able to further increase IL-10 production. So we are somehow reestablishing a pro-inflammatory, anti-inflammatory effect by increasing IL-10 production and decreased pro-inflammatory cytokines. The nerve. If you look here at behavior, we were able to see effect of behavior 1 week after injection. Actually, the effect was present even at shorter time. 3 days after cells, we were already able to decrease pain. If you look at the nerve, at shorter time, we did not see much. But if you go to longer time, we were able to observe the beginning of a regeneration phenomenon. The nerve is very damaged with the CCI. You see, these are all macrophages, which are actively phagocyting myelin. These are degenerating myelin fibers. And after cells, you still have damage. So it's not completely restoring the damage. But the macrophages appear smaller. You see some new myelinating fibers. So you see after stem cells, at longer time, a beginning of the cells, of regeneration of the nerve. So, and I go to conclude, in this second experiment, what we thought, what we observed, is that if you give the cells, you have present of the cells, of the stem cells at the lesion, you have a good effect on pain symptoms that last for a long period of time, you have a new balance, you can really restoration of the balance of pro-inflammatory, anti-inflammatory cytokines, and this is partially independent between nerve repair and neuropathic pain system modulation, because now nerve repair appears at longer time. So the idea is that we have a bidirectional interaction between the nerve environment and the nervous stem cells, which can lead to neuropathic pain relief, and these cells can really modulate these pro-anti-inflammatory cytokines which are present in the nerve and can trigger something that will lead then also to regeneration. So, in conclusion, what I showed to you is the idea that in pain we can now try to work not only on neurons, so not only targeting neuronal cells, but also targeting Schwann cells, macrophages, microglial cells, cioè all cells that are present in the nervous tissues and that by producing cytokines and other factors can participate in pain. However, from these studies, as well as from the inflammatory study, it is clear that the immune system in pain is involved not only as bad guy doing pain, but also as good guy trying to contrast pain. So it would not be so easy to target the immune cells because we have to target to reestablish the pro-inflammatory and the anti-inflammatory balance, which is naturally normally present in a nerve. And of course, if there are many questions, I'm here to answer.